Before this video officially begins, I would like to draw your attention to those two numbers on your screen. It's finally happened. The channel has surpassed 1 million lifetime views, and we've reached 864 subscribers. I'm sorry, I never got around to making the thank you video for 800 subscribers, and quite honestly, I might as well hold off now until we hit 900, because it's just unreal, the amount of exposure that this channel has gotten, the amount of you who have subscribed, the amount of you who have liked, the amount of you who have commented, the amount of you who have reached out to me in the comments or through Facebook messages. It's just been absolutely unreal. I have heard from so many of you from so many different places around the world, all of you from whatever backgrounds you may have, a very diverse audience that I have, and it's something that I am very humbled to see. The fact that the content that I'm creating is something that not only so many of you enjoy, but something that is inspiring you to start talking to each other, to start talking to me. I've heard from viewers all around the world, and it's just truly an eye-opening experience and very much a very humbling one. So once again, I would just like to say thank you so very much for your continued support, for your engagement, for your viewership, because I do this simply out of passion. I do this all by myself, for myself. I like sim racing, I like cars, I like motorsport, I like throwing things around in R-Factor, iRacing, and Assetto Corsa, so why not? A lot of it looks pretty cool, why not put it on the internet? And a lot of you think it looks pretty cool as well, so again, thank you all so very, very much for everything that you have done in terms of your subscriptions and your viewership and your comments. I try very hard to read all of the comments. I try to respond to a lot of them. It's difficult. It's really difficult because there truly are some days when I get emails all day long, and I'll look at my phone after coming out of work and I have 150 unread messages, and most of them are from YouTube comment notifications. It's just absolutely phenomenal to see the amount of engagement that I've gotten. So again, thank you all so very, very much. Thank you for your continued support. Thank you for your viewership. More videos are going to be going up all the time. Again, I do this simply out of love for cars, for racing, and for motorsport. And the fact that I'm able to use YouTube, the wonderful forum that it is, to disseminate this passion and to share it with all of you, to me, it truly is something unique and it truly is something special. So thank you all so very, very much. It's very, very humbling for me to be a small part of the sim racing community, and just thank you all so very, very much. The video that's coming up is a review of the 962 from Volume 2 of the Porsche pack in Assetto Corsa. I hope you all enjoy it very much. I certainly enjoyed making it. Stay tuned. Greetings all, Ferrariman601 here. The second volume of the Porsche packs was released last week for Assetto Corsa, as I'm sure all of you know by this point. In addition to the 919 hybrid, it features another Le Mans winning car, this one, the Porsche 962C. This car is an absolute legend in motoring history, and it sits in a place of honor in the hearts of petrolheads everywhere. Among other illustrious endurance championship events that it managed to win over the course of its relatively long racing career, in 1987 it won the 24 Hours of Le Mans in the hands of Hans Stuck, Derek Bell, and Al Hulbert, whose names you will see emblazoned on the doors here. Glorious stuff. There are a couple other reasons why this car is so memorable. Of course, it looks absolutely gorgeous. Just look at that. The blue, white, and red livery, that timeless ground effect shape. Just wonderful. But it's also a tank. This thing was reliable as all hell. Yes, in the 1987 race, there were some issues with the engine management computer. Somebody installed the wrong spec of microchip into the engine management software, and it created a lean fuel mixture, which caused some piston rings to burn up in some of the other cars. But number 17 managed to soldier on, completing 355 laps and taking the overall victory. Bulletproof Porsche reliability. The technical specs on this thing. First of all, we've got the engine. It is a nearly 3-liter flat six cylinder, so a Porsche flat six in this thing, of course keeping with the Porsche tradition. Heavily turbocharged, twin turbos on that engine, bringing the total power output to about 780 horsepower at 8200 RPM.
Also, because it's a 3-liter and it's a 6-cylinder, so I mean, it's pretty average in terms of a 6-cylinder displacement. Torque is pretty high as well, 710 newton meters, coming at 5,000 RPM. So your power band extends basically from 5,000 to 8,000 RPM. So that's a pretty wide range of drivability that you have. It makes for a very tractable driving experience, and provided you're not too enthusiastic on the throttle out of the corners, the car is actually pretty planted, as we will see in a few minutes when we get it out on track. Specific power output is 261 horsepower per liter, so 780 horsepower out of 3 liters, that's how we get to the 261 horsepower figure per liter. In terms of body construction, it is a creature of its time. The body is Kevlar and fiberglass, so we've got Kevlar and glass-reinforced plastic and some aluminum as well around the fuel tanks and the cockpit, but very lightweight construction. Yes, that is a composite material, carbon fiber as it were, however, it really didn't make it into sports cars yet, so we're still dealing with Kevlar and fiberglass. Of course, carbon fiber being used in Formula One since 1981 when McLaren debuted it, but sports cars were a little bit slower to adopt the technology. The chassis is sheet aluminum, and it's got a monocoque construction where the cockpit is, and then it has a rear subframe as well to which the engine and gearbox and suspension are mounted. Speaking of suspension, we have double wishbones, coilover springs, and dampers, and of course an anti-roll bar on the front. And we have lower wishbones, we have top rockers on the rear, and then again coil springs and an anti-roll bar. Rack and pinion steering. Disc brakes all around, they are cross-drilled and ventilated. The gearbox is a good old 5-speed manual, bulletproof gearbox from Porsche. Single clutch, a dry clutch, and of course it is rear-wheel drive. Wonderful, wonderful car. It weighs in at 900 kilos, it's 4.8 meters long, it's 2 meters wide, and it is 1 meter plus 80 millimeters high. So, great, great stuff. In Assetto Corsa, there are two variations of this car for your driving pleasure. We have this one, which is the Le Mans spec. It's got the long tail. You'll see that conspicuous rear overhang behind the rear wheels, hence the name long tail. There's also a short tail variant with a more traditional rear wing, and that rear valance is significantly shorter. They're essentially the same car, however, ergo I have chosen this one, the Le Mans spec, to review. But you can drive this one or the short tail. They are more or less the same. The short tail is a little bit more twitchy on the rear, I've noticed, but they're essentially the same car. Wonderful competition history on this thing, spanning all the way from 1985 to 1993. The last race that I have seen that it won was the 1993 Road America Grand Prix. So, a long history on this thing. Design work started probably in 1983, 1984, and then it made its debut, took its first win at the 1,000 kilometers of Mugello in 1985. So, very long career that this car had, which was more typical of that era. Nowadays, you see major teams designing new cars practically every year or every other year, such is the pace of development. But back then, perhaps it was a slightly simpler time, and they were able to squeeze some years out of these cars, which just made it better for us fans because we got to get used to the cars and learn to love them over the years that they were racing. In terms of what the car looks like in Assetto Corsa, details, lots of details. You'll see it certainly looks a whole lot more simple than the 919 that I reviewed previously, but again, for its era, this was spaceship, absolute spaceship. Kunos have done an absolutely wonderful job modeling the thing. Just look at the headlight lenses there. The inner lenses, where the bulbs are actually mounted, you'll see the Frenzel lensing there, but on the outer fairing, you see some nicks and cuts and scrapes and things. Just wonderful. It looks like the car's been raced, which is just what you want to see. Kunos really took their time to pay attention to detail, and you can get in close and see all those wonderful little Easter eggs that you maybe don't notice when you're farther out, and especially you won't notice them when you're on track, but in showroom view here, you can really take your time and appreciate all that stuff. You can see the mounting studs for the headlights there behind the lenses. Absolutely great. Absolutely great. Those wheels there that are designed to funnel air out of the brakes to keep everything cool. See the big single wheel nut in there with the scuff marks from the wheel gun. Wonderful. The valve stem on the tire, You could see that, and you can also see some lettering on the sidewall of the tire as well. Not talking about the Dunlop lettering, which of course is also impressive, but you can see the lettering on the sidewall talking about the specs of the tires, the mounting instructions, all that kind of stuff. Wonderful. Absolutely wonderful. Moving along the side here, see the shut lines are nicely rendered. Everything looks pretty even. You can see how the lettering breaks off between the shut lines there. Doesn't quite line up perfectly, just gives you that much more of a sense of realism. Absolutely great. See the exhaust there? Twin exhausts, one exhaust on each side. The bigger pipe is the engine exhaust, and then the shorter pipe, or the smaller pipe, rather smaller diameter, is for the turbo wastegate. Wonderful. And of course they spit fire. Gotta love it when it spits fire. To the rear of the car, you can see in the under tray, those are the Venturi tunnels. That is what is generating most of the downforce on this car. Ground effect is the name of the game, and those tunnels go a long way into producing ground effect. Wonderful. Peek through the rear valance there at the engine. Just great. Absolutely great. And that's so 80s. We have cooling issues. Well, what do? We got to get air out of the rear section of the car. Cut a hole in it. Wonderful. Just wonderful. Moving around top side, very clean lines, very simple bodywork. Really not much more than simple NACA ducts that are going in to create some ventilation for the engine there. Just wonderful. And of course you can see over the fenders, particularly the rear fenders, you've got some streaks there just to vent some high pressure air that can occur in the wheel wells just to keep those high pressure zones from forming and creating some lift where you don't want it. Looking into the cockpit there, it beckons us. We can open up the doors, and there we go, those dramatic gullwing doors that pop open. Look at how wide those sills are. I mean, you could very easily sit on that sill as it was. Getting in and out of this car in a hurry had to have been a chore, because that sill is a couple of feet wide. And then, of course, you have the cockpit. So, obviously those sills are housing radiators and probably electronics and things like that, but just, that's big. Of course, part of the reason for that, in addition to housing some of the mechanicals, was side impact protection. It's all aluminum, it's a box frame, probably pretty strong. And then into the cockpit, of course. In the cockpit, it is basic yet developed. It is gloriously shoddy, I must say. I don't mean shoddy in terms of poor workmanship. I mean shoddy in the sense of they're just bolts everywhere, and you can see where the different metal panels join up. It's a race car. I mean, there's just a hole there where some wires are going through. It's just there. it's great. It's absolutely great. Big dials, of course, for adjusting the turbo boost, the displays, the lights, things like that. And then, of course, you've got your steering wheel. Very simple steering wheel. It's basically like a road car. You've got a boost button for your turbos, maximum attack for overtaking, and a radio button, and that's about it, because we're talking 80s. It's mostly analog in here, which is wonderful. Big tachometer, which goes all the way up to 10,000 RPM. I mentioned earlier that the red line is 8,400, so you will see a very conspicuously placed red line at about 8,400 RPM, but wonderful. Absolutely wonderful. Gear lever over to the right. It's a 5-speed manual box. Can't get any more purist than this. We close the doors here and you can have a sense of what it's like with your sight lines. Pretty good visibility in this thing, I must say. This camera view is actually a little bit lower than where the driver's eye point is when you're on track, but you can get a sense of what your visibility is. Just a big windscreen in front of you, no big wheel arches unlike the modern LMP1 cars, so pretty much unhindered visibility all the way around 180 degrees around you. So great, great stuff. Looking along the sides here, you can see that cable release for the door so the driver can get out. Again, why bother putting in a door handle? It just weighs something, so put in a little leather strap that the driver can pull, hook it up to a cable, and then the door pops open. Great stuff. See in here, the seatbelt rendering, very nicely done. You can actually see the stitching on the seatbelts. Absolutely great. Moving off to the other side of the car, where theoretically a passenger could sit. There's a control box that's probably the computer for the engine management. And then you can see the chassis plate up in the rear section. Wonderful. Absolutely wonderful. This apparently is chassis number 006. Great. That ring that you can see below the chassis plate is most likely an engine kill. So in the event of an accident or whatever, The driver could switch the engine off. I bet that's also connected to a fire extinguisher. If I were a betting man, I would put money down on that, because twin turbos, things get very, very hot in there, and you have an oil leak, you're going to have a conflagration pretty quickly. But that's about it for the cockpit. Very sparse, very utilitarian, very racy. And of course, very cool. We go outside the car again, and we just have one last look before we take it out on track. Wonderful stuff. You're going to like this one, I guarantee it. We're going to Mugello today for the on-track portion of the review, and we'll see you there momentarily. Welcome to Mugello. Here we are in the pit lane. Of course, we're going to talk about some of the setup stuff and have another look at the car before we head out on track. But we are here at the site, as far as I'm able to research, don't quote me on stats like this, but as far as I'm able to research, Mugello is the site of the 962's first ever competition victory. In any event, here we are in the setup screen. All of these values are default values, so you can see our 5-speed box here, how our ratios are configured. This is Le Mans gearing. You'll see we max that at 221 miles per hour. That would be for the end of the Mulsanne Strait. I have to figure that they'd probably run slightly longer gears, either a longer 4th and 5th, or a higher final drive ratio for Le Mans, because 221 seems a little bit slow, actually, for Mulsanne, especially when you consider they didn't run the chicanes back then. But anyway, all default values on the setup. You can see our tires here, 3 compounds to choose from, soft, medium, and hard, all slicks, of course. For this run, we are going to select the medium compounds. Fuel. A large fuel tank in this car, but not as big as you might think. It's certainly not as small as the 919 that we saw. That only holds 68 liters of fuel. This one holds 99. But still, not quite as big a tank as you might expect on a car of this vintage. Turbocharging does help with fuel efficiency a little bit, but endurance racing, it's all about endurance, so you want as much gas in there as you can get on the pit stop, particularly at the start of a stint when you've got a new driver in there. Stay out as long as you can. Electronics. I'm not quite sure why they'd put turbos in the electronics section. I mean, on this car at least, the turbo is governed by a computer system, but turbos are mechanical devices? I don't know. But it's in the electronics page, and you can ramp your turbo up and down from 100% all the way down, oddly enough, to 0%. So I'm assuming 0% means the waste gates are completely open and the turbos are just venting to atmosphere. But the weird thing is, when you're in the car, you can adjust the turbo on the fly, but you can only go down to 10%, so you still get a little bit of boost there. This is a complete dumping of all boost pressure, and the engine is effectively normally aspirated at that point. So it's an interesting thing that you could do. Aero screen, very complex, I know. Rear wing and rear wing only. You've got 9 steps, including 0, so it goes up to 8 in the positive direction, and then it goes all the way down to 0. Unlike a couple other cars in this sim, you do not see the wings adjust as you make your adjustments in the pits, but there it is, 0 to 8 on the rear wing. That's about it. Your alignment settings, your camber and toe front and rear, your dampers, your bound and rebound front and rear, all 4 corners. And in your generics, of course, you've got brake bias and brake power. That brake power, of course, refers to the brake pressure that you get around the whole car, whether or not it's 1-to-1 in terms of what you're doing with the pedal, or at 50% it would be 1/2-to-1. You know, you could figure that out for yourself. And of course, brake bias, your brake power front to rear. Suspensions, you get your anti-roll bars, ride height, and wheel rates front and rear. Very nice. And that's about it as far as the setup goes. So we're going to put some gas in here. We're not going to fill the tank, of course, but put some in there so we can do something on this run. And we're going to run the medium compound tires. Go out here, and I'll give you a chance to hear the external sounds. And you can see those nice flames shooting out of the exhaust there. Glorious. Alright, so in the cockpit, just want to point out 2 things to you. Obviously, you've got your tachometer behind the steering wheel, but to the left of the tachometer, you have a display that shows you your fuel level remaining, so 44 liters remaining. And to the near extreme left of the screen, you can see that second display where you see 0.0 and 0%. That is our turbo boost pressure, the 0.0, and the turbo percentage out of 100 that we have commanded. So we set it to zero in the pits and it remains at zero, and you'll notice that we get no boost pressure whatsoever. In any event, clutch in, first gear, and off we go. Careful not to stall it with this long gearing. Going to be careful on this outlap here, just trying to get some heat in the brakes and tires. Again, we've got the medium compound tires on, so they are a little bit grippy, but again, we're talking 1980s, so they won't come up to temperature quite as much as you'd like, and even though they are labeled mediums, they are quite harder than a modern medium would be. Hear some nice sounds there as I roll onto the throttle. One thing that you're not hearing at the moment, though, is the wastegate popping off. Because we're at 0% on the turbo, and you can see or confirm that on that left side screen, there is no boost pressure to vent. So that blow-off valve has nothing to blow off. See here, with no boost, the engine's very docile, very tractable. High revs are still the power band, but not nearly as much as they will be in mere moments when we dial it up to 100% race boost in 3, 2, 1, hold on! And that is the song of 780 horsepower going down the start-finish straight here at Mugello. Those front tires and the rear tires, for the most part, are still not up to temperature in any regard, so I've still got to be quite careful as we go around this first sector. Brakes are starting to grab, though. That's good. Now as I come off the throttle, you hear the wastegates popping off. That is a very nice touch. All right, now we're starting to get some temperature in the front end. Starting to bite a little bit more. Rear is also quieted down some. Still a little squirrely under braking, though. Gotta watch that. Very, very nice. I'm happy now with where the tires are. We can start to get on with the program a little bit. You'll notice that the boost pressure goes up to 1.5 bar. So that really doesn't seem so spectacular when you consider cars like the 98T, which go up to 5 bar in qualifying trim. But you've also got to remember, this car had to do 24 hours. So surely they could have put some bigger turbos on it or made the wastegates hold on a little bit longer, but you wouldn't want to do that. Anything that's going to hurt your reliability, do not put it on the car. To win a 24-hour race, you must first finish a 24-hour race. Yeah, it's just so nice when you're coming out of a corner and you can just come onto the power. Let the car drift out wide like that over the crest here, one of my favorite spots in all of racing, to be honest. I love the exit of that corner at the top of the hill here at Mugello. Back end still reminding me who's really in charge here. And the blips that you gotta do on the downshift. If you're not good at heel-toe, you're not gonna like this car, only because you really have to hit the throttle a lot to rev match on your downshifts. Like, you basically have to reach full throttle while you're braking. So it's fun. It's a lot of fun. Down the straight, I have no idea how fast we're going. No speedometer, of course. Who cares? Turn one, the camber helps you a little bit, but you've still got to be careful on the noisy pedal. A little bit of a drift through there. Wide of the apex, but we can make up for it with a lurid slide on the exit. Here's it bounces off the rev limiter. You can hear the wastegates pop open. They're acting as a rev limiter in their own right. Very cool. Diving down the hill now, being careful on the throttle, letting the front end do the work, and then hard on the gas over those curbs on the exit. Absolutely glorious stuff. I know the car is not that fast compared to more modern machines, but it's so involved what you're doing in here. It's not like the 919. The 919 is ridiculously fast compared to this thing. It's almost as fast as a Formula One car, that thing. But there's just so much to do in here. There's so much to look at. There's so much to think about as you're going around. Just operating this car, I mean, it's so reliable and it's so predictable that you can get yourself almost lost in thought in here as you're just going through your gear changes. It becomes hypnotic. The drone of that engine is, in a strange way, it's calming. And just all of the subtle hues in here of the black and gray of the interior, your exposed metal, the soft lit gauges, which I actually don't think are backlit at all. That would have been trouble at night. But just the atmosphere in here, the blue around the dash, it's almost comforting in some regards. It's a little bit strange. You're dealing with one of the most legendary, awesome Le Mans cars in history, but the feeling that I get in here is almost one of solitude. This is one of those cars that has a personality. Not quite sure how I would describe it, but it's loyal, it's capable, but it's also modest. It doesn't want to be flashy, it doesn't want to be loud, it just wants to be quiet, put its head down, and get the job done. It doesn't surprise you in any bad ways. It's just there for you all the time. The stability through the chassis is absolutely wonderful, I must say. There is understeer as you go into the corners, but you counter it through braking appropriately and just hesitating on the throttle where you need it. And then about mid-corner, when you start applying some serious power again, The back end just ever so slightly caresses the tarmac and just reminds you, no, not quite yet. Bleed off the throttle just a touch. For some of the tighter corners, getting on the power is a little bit more perilous. It will want to go sideways, so just be mindful of that. And of course, if you have any experience in other turbocharged cars, you will know what I mean. When the rear tires suddenly approach and exceed their limit of adhesion. This is just a really, really nice experience, I must say. In terms of how the car feels force feedback-wise, the steering is heavy. But it's a good kind of heavy. You can feel things. You can be precise with your inputs. Normally, you'll see in a lot of my onboard footage, I'm sort of juggling the wheel around like that. But there's no need to do that in this. It's just very solid, it's very reassured, it knows where it is. You only have to turn in once and then just make slight adjustments to hold your line. Then unwind it and head for the exit. My second gear in here. Much more lively there. Stay in second. Yeah. The guys who drove this thing, they must have been very patient, because the back end will slide. It doesn't do it in an abrupt or erratic way, it just does it. And once you're aware of it, and you'll be prepared for it, and it's no problem. But it does require patience. I'd imagine in a very heated race situation where you're going wheel to wheel for position, you might get caught out by that rear end just breaking free a little bit. But for the most part, just pounding laps in. Very, very reasonable. This car definitely does not want me dead, unlike its older brother, the 917. I'm just really, 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 really liking this. It has a temperament almost of a road car in a lot of senses. It's just very compliant. Like I was talking about in the showroom, the engine is tractable. Has a wide power band. All of your gears are well spaced to keep you in that power band. I mean, I'm in third here, and I'm still pretty much in the power band, even at that low speed. In many ways, it almost feels like a daily commute. It's that compliant. If my daily commute were the Mulsanne Straight, I think I might have to get myself one of these. And I think, oddly enough, Porsche did sell a few of these cars to private owners. And I'm not just talking privateers who had racing teams. I'm talking about just everyday people who could happen to afford it. And I think that a few of those cars were actually street legal. So, in other words, me likening this to a road car in a lot of ways is not that far off. It just feels so usable. If somebody gave this to me and said, you have to drive this every day to do your daily business for a year, I would say, all right, I could make that work. I don't think I'd complain about usability or tractability. I'd probably complain about storage space more than anything else, but that's about it. I could totally drive this to work. Yet it also does 240 miles an hour. It doesn't get much better than this. Oh, Germans, why are you so good at building cars? Yes, I know the Germans invented the car as we know it, but they're just so good at it. There's that mid-corner understeer starting to act up. Front tires are probably starting to go off a little, but just a little bit of mid-corner understeer to keep you honest. And of course the rear end comes to play again. No big deal. If I could give you a comparison that you might identify with, if any of you have ever driven a pickup truck, an open back truck, in the rain, unladen, so no load, you'll know the back end likes to break free, but it's very easily recoverable. That's what this feels like. It's like driving a pickup truck in the rain. Back to the pits. Let's pull up. And we'll switch off. It's such a dichotomy, this thing. It does 240 miles an hour at one Le Mans, but I wasn't anticipating the review to go in this direction, but it's so livable. I mean, I could seriously take one of these and drive it to work every day and not feel intimidated. It's such a contradiction. I mean, look at it. You would expect this thing to have axe murderer written all over it, but no, not in the least. It's a baby. It really is. Yes, it's a very fast baby, but it's a baby, you know? I don't know what to say. All I know is it's put a smile on my face, maybe for some reasons that I wasn't anticipating, but it's just so nice to drive. It's so nice to drive. If you want to go sideways, it'll go sideways. If you want to go fast, it'll go fast. If you want to cruise around in fifth gear around all the corners, it'll do that too. It's everything. It does everything really well. So take that as you may, but it is in the Porsche Pack, Volume 2 of the Porsche Pack for Assetto Corsa, released last week. If you've got the Porsche Pack already and you haven't driven this car, please drive this car. You will not be sorry you did. Also, drive the 919 while you're at it, because that thing is a real kick in the pants. But this, if you're into now classic Le Mans cars, this is certainly fitting that description. So go for it. If you don't have the Porsche Pack Volume 2, it is $6.99 on Steam. Certainly is not going to break your bank. You will enjoy it. It's a wonderful addition to Assetto Corsa, along with the first volume of the Porsche Pack. We're still awaiting Volume 3, the third and final installment of that. I believe that comes out in another couple of weeks, so we're going to be looking forward to that as well. As always, stay tuned for two hot laps coming up without my commentary and from some external views as well. So stay tuned for that. You'll also get to hear those external sounds a little bit better in the context of an actual race pace run. So stay tuned for the hot laps. Until next time, Ferrariman601 saying thank you very, very much for watching.
cool.